Oh, Father, we thank you. We are so grateful, Lord, that you have been faithful through the ages, oh God, and you have been faithful to us as well in this generation. For this is the generation, oh God, who seek your face and who worships you in spirit and in truth. So let truth be known tonight. Holy Spirit, have your way in our midst tonight. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Amen. So we are dealing with a subject called that I may know him. That I may know him. We got our scripture from Philippians chapter 3. I want you to open to Philippians chapter 3. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version, and then we will take it also from the Message translation. Philippians chapter 3 verse 10. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death. Amen. We see from the Message translation. The Message translation said, I gave up all that inferior stuff so I could know Christ personally, experience his resurrection power, be a partner in his suffering, and go all the way with him to death itself. This is the Message translation. And you know that the Message translation most of the time opens it up and breaks it down to our language today. Praise God. So that we in this generation can relate better. So the translation sometimes adds a lot of aspects, a lot of dimensions to it, and it brings a clearer picture. I suggest always that you read the scriptures and, if possible, read it from different angles. Find different translations and get a broader picture of what the scripture is trying to say. Praise God. For instance, at the end of verse 10, the New King James will say, being conformed to his death. Being conformed to his death. To his death. But you see that Message translation says, and go all the way with him to death itself. And go all the way with him to death itself. I believe that most of the people will read this and it will kind of frighten them a little bit, because when you talk about death, it freaks people out in a certain aspect of their lives. Amen. So we have been dealing with this, and we have set a season apart, aside, so that we will get to know Christ. We'll get to know him only not in the aspect of realization, but we want to know him consummately. We want to know him intimately. And it is very, very important, very, very important that we know him intimately. Praise God. And I have rolled out a few steps that we can take if we want to know Christ and live him out. So I said 10 steps for knowing Christ and living him out. I gave the first step in John 14, verse 21 and 23. We read that we have to know him through his word. We have to know him through his word. And when we read verse 21 and verse 23, we see that what attracts the Trinity to come to you and make their dwelling with you is His word. If you follow and do His word, it attracts them to you and for them to make their dwelling with you. And number two, the second step, I said that we have to never to forget to employ the services of the Holy Spirit. And I gave the scripture in John chapter 14, verse 25 to 26. It says, we can never know Christ personally unless through the Holy Spirit, unless the Holy Spirit expose Him to us so that we are able to know Him intimately. Praise God. And the third step I gave is that for us to get to the process of knowing Him and living Him out, number three, we have to know about Him. Then when we know about Him, we have to participate. We have to participate in whatever we have known about Him. And when we participate in whatever we have known, then we will begin to experience, His resurrection power. Because it is only through doing that you get to have experience or get to have a resume. Praise God. In our modern lifestyle, when you go to look for a job, and a serious job will ask you for your resume, and you can't fake your resume. If you fake your resume, it will catch up with you. Hallelujah. If you fake your resume, it will catch up with you because you have said it on paper that this is what you have done and this is your experience. So in during the course of your new job, they will begin to give you assignment based on your resume. And if you lied, guess what? Your lies will catch up with you. Just like in America. Some people have lied so many times on so many aspects, thinking that they are lying to a computer. But guess what? One of these days, your lies will get to you. Praise God. I was talking to somebody this afternoon, and he said, and she said to me that America will always give you a very long rope. America will always give you a very long rope. Don't think they don't know where you are. Don't think they don't know what you are doing. But they have a very big stick and they have a very long rope. Praise God. And if you think you have had your way and you keep on having your way, one day your rope will get shorter and shorter and shorter and it will catch up with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As I give you this story, an illustration comes to my mind. Illustration comes to my mind about O.J. Simpson. You understand? O.J. Simpson. And when he was acquitted, when he was found not guilty of the murder of Nicole, his wife, you know, people kept on saying that, don't worry, he's not off the hook yet. You know, because America has a long rope. And one of these days is going to catch up with him. You understand? And I believe that it did. Praise God. It is just by the grace of God that you will have a case or you have an issue and go to court and you come back home safely. It is just by the grace of God. Because there are so many ways in the book. If they want to clobber you, if they want to hook you up, there are so many ways in the book that they will be able to hook you up. So if you go and you come back home, you must praise God. Praise God. Some people just tend to take these things for granted, but it is not as easy as we think. Praise God. So you got to know and participate in and then have your experience or have your resume. I mean, if you have the previous preaching, you have the CD, you get to have more detail of what we have been sharing. Praise God. But tonight, somebody say tonight. Hallelujah. Somebody say tonight. Say tonight is tonight. Hallelujah. We are taking it further. We are taking it further. So tonight I am sharing on knowing the great I am. Knowing the great I am. Please say with me. Knowing the great I am. A little bit louder. Knowing the great I am. Or even more louder. Knowing the great I am. Praise God. Knowing the great I am. The one who said, I am that I am. Knowing that person. Praise God. And we realize that all of us, you and I, we all have interests. Somebody say interest. And we all have ambitions. Say ambitions. And we all have aspirations. Say with me, aspirations. Praise God. It doesn't matter what goals you have in life. Either spiritual goals or physical goals. These focus, whatever your focus is, whatever your drive is, if you are not, or if you pay attention to these drives, these ambitions, these interests, these aspirations, it either will take you up the ladder or what? Bring you down to the grave or bring you down to the ditch. You cannot stay in the middle unless you are just doing it anyhow. But if you really want to pursue, if you really want to press, you will get there by hooks or by crooks, or whatever you are pursuing, if it is something that is so dangerous, something that is so out of order, it can lead you to your untimely death. Whatever goal it is, whatever goal it is, whatever goal you are driving at, whatever drives you in the morning to go out and come back in, if your zeal, somebody says zeal, if your zeal is not guarded, if your zeal for that particular goal, for that particular agenda, or for that particular interest is not guarded, that zeal, the same zeal, can lead you to a catastrophic end and lead you to your untimely death. Amen. Amen. So I know that people who have fallen in love with certain girl, and they just cannot close their eyes without thinking about that girl. And because of their zeal to win the heart of God, that will lead them to their untimely death. Praise God. And some of them also have succeeded. Bless God. So in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, we see the focus of this man of God, Paul, called Paul. This man of God called Paul, he had in his heart to know Christ. Not only about him, but to know him consummately. Remember that Christ, Paul heard about Christ, and then he decided to go and kill Christ. Because if you kill his people, you are killing him. Praise God. So he knew about him. But when Christ finally revealed himself to him, from that moment, he began his pursuit. He began his pursuit. What was his pursuit? His pursuit is to know him. That's why he said in chapter 3, verse 10 of Philippians, in a Message translation, he said, I gave up all that inferior stuff. In fact, can you let us read from verse 8? From verse 8 to 11. I want to get the Message translation. Or let's get from chapter 3 from verse 1 to 11. I want you to read it from the Message translation and it will baffle your mind. Praise God. Praise God. Look at from verse 1. He says, and that's about it. Friends, be glad in God. I don't mind repeating what I have written in earlier letters. I hope you don't mind hearing it again. Better safe than sorry. So here goes. Steer clear of the barking dogs. Other translation says, beware of dogs. Bobo bobo, beware of dogs. Yeah. Steer clear of the barking dogs, those religious busybodies. All bark and no bite. All they are interested in is appearance. Knife ready, knife happy circumcisers. I call them. He called them knife happy circumcisers. The real believers are the ones the Spirit of God leads to work away at this ministry, filling the air with Christ's praise as we do it. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. We couldn't carry this off by our own efforts, and we know it. How many of you bear witness that whatever you are having right now in Christ, the level that you are right now in Christ, you are not here because you are smart. It's because of His Spirit, because of the power of the Holy Ghost at work in your life. I'm telling you, man, what Christ is doing in Crown House Chapel, it baffles my own understanding. It baffles my own understanding. Praise God. Praise God. This shows me that when Christ gives you an assignment, just be obedient and go. Hallelujah. Because His word is a lamp unto your feet. And the lamp only can give. How many of you know that the light shines brighter than the lamp? You know that light shines brighter than lamp. Lamp only can give you a parameter where you can see, only to give you a glimpse of where you are standing and where you can take your next step, but it doesn't give you a whole lot of mileage. But light can shine and you can see far away. Hallelujah. So His word is a lamp onto your feet so that you can see where to take your next step. And the Bible says that same word is a light onto your path. Your feet will allow you to see what you are standing on and where you are standing. If you are standing on Christ, you know you are standing on Christ because His word will confirm that in your heart. Hallelujah. His word will confirm that in your heart. Your spirit will click. Hallelujah. But you see, when it comes to your path, that same word, as you begin to move, you see that the light begins to break forth. The light begins to break forth, and then you begin to see a little bit far. You begin to see a little bit far. You begin to see a little bit far. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I obeyed His voice when He came to me and He said, go, find your church and start. I said, yes, sir. I didn't know where. I didn't know how. But I obeyed the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit said, come to Alexandria. We came to Alexandria and then we started. Praise God. But myself, I am very, very excited. And on the other aspect of it, I am very, very shocked at how far the Holy Spirit has brought this ministry. Not in terms of numbers, but in terms of spiritual maturity. Hallelujah. In terms of spiritual maturity. I can tell you, most of you will call me sometimes. Say, Pastor, this is what the Lord has revealed to me. Praise God. And guess what? 2 or 3 days' time, bam, you see it happening. Some of you, by the time you finish saying it, it's already happening. Hallelujah. And it excites me so much knowing that God is real. Hallelujah. So don't take things for granted in Crown House Chapel. You are planted well. You are planted well. You are planted well. Hallelujah. So he said in verse 4 in the Message translation, even though we can list what many might think are impressive credentials, you know my pedigree, a legitimate birth, circumcised on the eighth day, an Israelite from the elite tribe of Benjamin, a strict and devout adherence to God's law. Now he's beginning to talk to us about his resume, what he has achieved in the area of culture, in the area of inheritance, in the area of credentials, what he has achieved through his education. He's beginning to tell us. He says, a fiery defender of the purity of my religion, even to the point of persecuting Christians, a meticulous observer of everything set down in God's law book. Go ahead, verse 7. Verse 7. You see what Paul is trying to say? He's now beginning to break down his pedigree. He's beginning to break down what he has been doing, because he sees people boasting. And he said those people are just fuming. They don't have any teeth to bite. But now he's telling us what he has left behind. He says, the very credentials these people are waving around as something special, I am tearing up and throwing it out with the trash, along with everything else I used to take credit for. And why? Because of Christ. Somebody say, because of Christ. Hallelujah. Somebody say, because of Christ. See, he says, yes, all the things I once thought were so important are gone from my life. Can somebody bear witness to this? Hallelujah. All the things that you were so fired up about, now you look back and you say, oh my God. So I spent all my years chasing after this, because you find yourself having a better deal now. Hallelujah. Compared to the high privilege of knowing Christ Jesus as my master. Firsthand, everything I once thought I had going for me is insignificant dog dung. That's a good word, dung. Because if you were to tell me to use my own word, well, you would not like that word. Hallelujah. But dung is a well-polished. I have dumped it all in the trash so that I could embrace Christ. Somebody say, embrace Christ. Hallelujah. And you see, and be embraced by him. I didn't want some petty, inferior brand of righteousness that comes from keeping a list of rules when I could get the robust kind that comes from trusting Christ. God's righteousness. Do you see what he's saying? I said to you that before you could become righteous in those days, rules that you have to follow. And Paul said, I have done all of this, but I didn't want that. You see, he says, I didn't want, go back to verse 9. He says, I didn't want some petty, inferior brand of righteousness that comes from keeping a list of rules when I could get the robust, somebody say robust, when I could get the robust kind that comes from trusting Christ, God's righteousness. Is somebody here with me? Hallelujah. And verse 10, our topic is in verse 10. I gave up all that inferior stuff so I could know Christ personally, experience his resurrection power, be a partner in his suffering, and go all the way with him to death itself. Verse 11. If there was any way to get in on the resurrection from the dead, I want to do it. Somebody say, I want to do it. Somebody say, I want to do it. Hallelujah. You read things like this, and you will see that you are not the only person who left the world behind and the focus on the cross ahead of you. You are not the only one who left everything else to pursue Christ, because you saw how he listed his credentials. Praise God. He was a Benjamite. He was a Benjamite. A Hebrew of Hebrew. Praise God. And yet he said, when I found Christ, I put everything aside. Didn't I tell you in church that you don't try to connect with God through your mind? It's not possible. It will leave you helpless. It will leave you heartbroken and depressed. And you will turn around and go home and you will say, Christianity is not for me. Praise God. Praise God. Focus on Christ. Focus on Christ. Hebrews chapter 12. Look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. The author and the finisher. I am an author of a book. So when he says author, it means the person who really put it together. The person who really... So your faith was authored by somebody. And he's the one who authored it. And he's the one who is going to finish it. And who is the, he's the one who is going to perfect it for you. All you need to do is focus on him. Somebody say focus. Somebody say focus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What I don't want you guys to do is a copycat Christianity. Because somebody did this. And you also, when you take the mic, you want to do the same. It will not work. Because that person's anointing was custom made for him alone. You are special. You are unique. Yours is custom made for you. Oh, how I wish you would practice what is in you. Over the years, as you have followed Christ, over the years, the anointing has been piling up to this time. It is in you. It is in you. Some of you, it is bottled up. All you need to do is that through this season, you have to have a goal in your heart. You have to have a goal in your heart that I want to achieve this. Some of you, it is your morning devotion. Your morning devotion is suffering violence. Some of you, during this period, you set that goal, oh Holy Spirit, oh that I may know Christ. I may know Christ, and also that you will help me rescue my morning devotion life. Some of you, it is your church attendance. You are slow now. Oh, that should be one of your goals as this season is set apart. It is bottled up in you. It is bottled up in you. Hallelujah. Christ brings joy and fulfillment to your life. But if you don't focus on him and you focus on somewhere else, it brings frustration. He said, in me you shall find peace. But in the world, there's a lot of tribulations. When he called Peter to come on the water, Peter's eyes was fixated on Christ and he began to walk. He didn't pay attention that he was walking on water, but he was paying attention to the face of God and he was following the voice that has called him. So he kept going. He kept going until the wind began to blow, until the storms began to come. And then he moved his eyes to look at the storm. Suddenly, he saw that he was walking on water. It's not possible for a mere man to walk on water. Why am I walking on water? The moment doubt set in, he began to sink. He began to sink. He began to sink. The moment, as a Christian, the moment you remove your eyes from Christ and look somewhere, that is the beginning of your downfall. That's the beginning of your downfall. That's the beginning of your downfall. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, I have a goal for this season. I have a goal for this season. And I've prayed to the Holy Spirit about it. I've prayed to heaven about it. And I know that by the end of this season, I will rescue whatever goal that I have in my heart. But my primary goal is to know him and the power of his resurrection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Paul said, I have thrown everything away. I've thrown everything away that I may know him. Because I don't want anything to be a stumbling block between me and Christ. Praise God. Verse 12. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you soaking in so far? Are you soaking in? Praise God. Praise God. Don't let me lose you. Just fix your eyes on what we are doing. Praise God. And it will begin to make sense to you. I have a lot to share with you. He says, I am not saying that I have this all together. Me neither. Somebody say, me neither. Hallelujah. That I have it made. But I am well on my way. Somebody say, I am well on my way. Hallelujah. Somebody say, I am not where I used to be. Oh, but I am on my way. With the help of the Holy Ghost, I will be there. Hallelujah. He says, but I am well on my way, reaching out for Christ, who has so wondrously reached out for me. Wondrously reached out for me. Praise God. Praise God. Don't you want to know why Christ chose you? Don't you want to know it? Don't you want to know? Don't you want to receive everything that there is? Hallelujah. I want it. Everything. Everything. Hallelujah. So tonight, my topic for tonight is knowing the great I am. Knowing the great I am. Knowing the great I am. So we see that he began to list his credentials. He began to boast a little bit. But you see, the man of God came to his senses. And he said, all of these things that I have achieved by reason of ancestry, by reason of descent, by reason of inheritance, by reason of status, by reason of achievement, rectitude, influence, etc., etc. He said, all of these I have thrown it away because it did not profit me. It did not profit me. All you get is head knowledge. Head knowledge. Head knowledge. Head knowledge. How many ministries have you gone and it's so dry? It's so dry. Although you see thousands of people, and yet it's so dry. Because it's about head knowledge, head knowledge, head knowledge. And yet the Bible says, those who worship me must worship me in spirit and in truth. Praise God. Praise God. He says, I threw all this away so that I may gain Christ. I may gain Christ. Somebody say, I may gain Christ. Hallelujah. Because he want to know Christ. Not only know about him, but want to know him consummately. Do you know him, sir? Do you know him, ma'am? Do you know him? Do you know him? Hallelujah. Do you know him? That's a question that you continue to ask yourself. And this question will drive you to your knees, I bet you. This question, if you ask yourself daily, it will drive you to your knees. To drive you to your knees. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said that I may know him. Let's read the book of Acts. Go to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 9. Oh, I am fired up for tonight. Hallelujah. 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 Acts chapter 9, verse 5. Well, you know, let's read from verse 1. So we'll get the clear picture. Praise God. And take me away from the Message translation. Get me to New International Version. New King James Version. So take me away from Message translation. Praise God. Although the Message will break it out, but I want us to follow along with my translation. You know what? Just leave it there. Leave it there. Leave it there. Leave it there. I'll read from my Bible, and then we will see from the projector, from the Message. Hallelujah. So verse 1. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way. Somebody say the way. Somebody say the way. See, when we started, we were not called Christians. When we started, after Christ left and the Holy Spirit came and the church started, we were not called Christians. We were called the way. John 14, 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. So when they were looking for a name for the movement, they called it the way. They called it the way. Praise God. Until later down the line, where Paul and his team, people saw the way they were conducting themselves and they called them Christians because they were behaving like Christ. And that's how come we all got the name Christians. Praise God. So he said, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Do you know Jesus know your name? Hallelujah. Even the enemy, the one who thought Jesus was his enemy, Jesus knew his name. Yeah, hallelujah. And that is comforting. That is so comforting to me. And he knows my name. He knows my name. My sister, he knows your name. Yes, yes, hallelujah. Heaven knows your name. You belong to a kingdom and you are not a stranger. Hey, 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 hey. You are not illegal alien. Yes, yes. You are not illegal alien. That your name is not in the system. Hallelujah. Your name is in the system. Praise God. You are a bona fide citizen. You are in there. And you have the right to everything because you are a citizen. So he called him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? Then he said, I am. Somebody say, I am. Somebody say, I am. And that is why my title tonight is called Knowing the Great I Am. He said, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am. Jesus, whom you are persecuting, it is hard for you to kick against the goats. So let's read the Message translation. Go back to verse 1. Go back to verse 1 for me. Go back to verse 1 for me. Look at the Message translation. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. Oh, give me a Message translation. MSG. Hallelujah. MSG. It's good to sometimes do your Bible study with all the translations. It helps you to give you a bigger picture. Message. He says, all this time Saul was breathing down the necks of the master's disciples out for to kill. He went to the chief priest. Verse 2. And got arrest warrants to take to the meeting places in Damascus, so that if he found anyone there belonging to the way, whether men or women, he could arrest them and bring them to Jerusalem. That is Paul for you. That is the beginning of Paul. That's why all these fetish priests who is preaching on TV and stuff like that, I told you guys, the Lord has touched that man. It's only a matter of time. It's only a matter of time. Hallelujah. Verse 3. He set off. When he got to the outskirts of Damascus, he was suddenly dazed by a blinding flash of light. Verse 4. As he fell to the ground, he heard a voice. Saul, Saul, why are you out to get me? I like it. Why are you out to get me? Hallelujah. He said, who are you, master? I am Jesus, the one you are hunting down. The one you are hunting down. Have you come out to hunt for a dog? I am Jesus. Hallelujah. I am Jesus. Do you know that this response from Jesus telling Saul that I am, only this response broke something in the heart of Saul. It broke that man. It broke him down completely. I'm telling you, if you come to Christ and you are still, for so many years, the barriers are still erected and you are still carrying your baggage, you have not met Christ yet. You have not met Christ yet. Because the moment you meet Christ, this Christ that I'm preaching to you, the moment you meet him, something will break. It will break big time. The walls will crumble down. Hallelujah. Because you have to know that this man of God, he was not ignorant. He was not ignorant. He was not broke. He was not a man who doesn't have money. I mean, for you to go to the high priest, you must be a big dog. You can't just walk to the high priest and ask favors. Yeah, you must be somebody who carries power. You understand? Yeah. You can't just walk to White House and go see Obama. Who born monkey? Yeah. You understand? So for the high priest to entrust him with this kind of authority, to go to the whole of Damascus and go and arrest everybody, this man must be a big man. And he goes with soldiers with him. He commands the soldiers what to do. And yet he met Christ. And Christ said, I am. And from that moment, the whole life of that man changed. From that moment, because a new era has begun for him. All that he has known, all that his grandfathers have taught him, all that his education has taught him, he began to put all of them back because all that wall has crumbled down. Now he is helpless before this Jesus that I am persecuting. You see Jesus shining like a light and you only have a sword in your hand. Are you going to kill the light? You cannot kill the light. Are you hearing me? Yes. The one that you are persecuting has now appeared to you. Appeared to you. He is now real to you. He's not fake. He thought the disciples were faking. He thought Jesus had not risen up. So the disciples were faking and they were cheating people and duping people. So he Judaism person who has been to school and he was almost a rabbi. So he took matters into his hands. I'll go and teach these people a lesson. Only to find out that he was on his road to his destiny. And he met this Jesus. Oh, so Jesus is alive for real. Here I am and here you are. So something broke in his spirit. And that was a turning point in his life. Are you hearing me? That was a turning point in his life. That was a turning point in his life. Praise God. Praise God. Then he decided in his heart to pursue this one who said to him, I am. I have to find out. I have to know him. Because he knew that from the Old Testament, all the time when God is introducing himself, he calls himself, I am. I am. I am. And now he has appeared to me. And he has called me into his job. He has called me to work with him. I must know him. I must know him. Not only know about him, but know him personally. And you know that alone, that answer that Jesus gave him alone, sent him to Arabia. Paul went to Arabia. Some Bible theologians have said that he went to Bible school in Arabia. He went to Arabia for almost 3 years. Nobody heard of him. Yes. To search for him. To search for the one who told him, I am. For 3 years, he was on a quest. He was on a quest. He was on a quest. Hallelujah. He was on a quest. Somebody say a quest. Hallelujah. He was on a quest to find the one who said, I am that I am. Praise God. Praise God. The moment he said, who are you, Lord? Jesus said to him, I am. At that moment, all the walls began to crumble. The walls of resistance that he was working in, that wall began to crumble. The wall of pride. Because when you come to Christ, you can't come with your own pride. No. You have to submit yourself under his umbrella. All these began to crumble down. All began to crumble down. The walls of philosophy, the walls of religion. Religion is killing most of Christians. Religion is killing most of Christians. The wall of religion for Saul began to crumble down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And tonight, as we have gathered here, I stand in authority as the anointed of the Lord, and I speak into your life. Every wall, I command that wall to come down now in the name of Jesus. You wall of pride, I command you to come down now in the name of Jesus. You wall of religion, I command you to come down now in the name of Jesus. Every wall of philosophies, I command you to come down now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, let God arise and let every wall crumble down in the name of Jesus. 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 Some of you are struggling with walls of immorality. You cannot keep your eyes off somebody's wife. You cannot keep your eyes off somebody's girlfriend. Today I speak to that wall. Come down now in the name of Jesus. We refuse you and we refuse you. Let Christ arise and these walls come down. You walls of poverty, tonight I call you forth. Come down now in the name of Jesus. You walls of joblessness, tonight I curse you. Come down now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Christ is arising in Crown House Chapel, and every wall come under my feet in the name of Jesus. 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 The wall began to come down for the man of God, because he has met the great I am. That great I am is here tonight and he's speaking into your life. Every wall cannot stand and live in the same temple with this great I am. His name is Jesus, the Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach. He's the one who conquered death. He's the one who went to hell and got the keys of life, and he has given that keys to you. Every door must open in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I feel the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Many people come to Christianity. We come for all kinds of reasons. Some people come for deliverance. Some come for finances. Some come for refuge. Some come for marriage issues. Some come for peace of mind. Some come for salvation. But hey, when you come and you accept Christ and you are baptized and you begin to pay attention to his word, as the preacher preaches the word, as I'm preaching the word tonight to you, something begins to bubble within you. And the word as the preacher preaches seems to want to know, and you want to know more. You want to know about him. What you are doing and what is happening is that you are beginning to see a glimpse of eternity, a glimpse of him. The great I am is working on you. Some of you, the work is a little bit slow. Some of you, the work is a little bit fast. But keep coming. Keep coming. He's working on you. 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 Hallelujah. Praise God. Something that we say in our Akan language. Onyame fane bua ontunintem. Yes. When God picks up a stone, he doesn't throw it immediately. Because he always wants to hit the target. Hallelujah. And most of the time, he will prepare you and 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 prepare you. And one of these days, the light is going to come blazing in your heart. And you will say, now I know him. Now I know the power of his resurrection. Now I know him. I speak into your life and I call that resurrection power in your life to arise now in the name of Jesus. To arise now in the name of Jesus. I remember when I started playing in church, some musicians, they play in church, they still take it for granted. They think it's a joke or it may be whatever. Hallelujah. I remember when I started, sometimes they have to beg me to come and play. Sometimes, they have to beg me. I was the cutest boy in town. You understand? And I know how to play. God has gifted me. You know, I thought I was doing Christ a favor. After all, the church doesn't pay me. I get more money from the club. I get more money from the secular band. The church doesn't pay me. So who born you, pastor, to come and force me to come? I say all of this to glorify the name of God. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Praise God. But you see, the pastor was so good. Big heart. With all my pride and stupidity, he would still call me. Come to my home. Talk to me nicely. And by the time he finished talking, I find myself in church. You understand? I kept coming. I kept coming. Then the walls began to break down. 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 I got to a point where some churches began to pay me. All of that time, the walls began to break down. And I got to a point in my life, I didn't need any money again. Because I saw that I am to be at his service. It's not I that I'm doing him favor. He is the one who is doing me a big favor by serving him. Hallelujah. By serving him. By serving him. And now, if you ask me, I'll give everything out just to hold on to Jesus Christ. Because I know that what I'm getting from him, money cannot give to me. 1,000 years of experience cannot give this to me. Hallelujah. I pray that you know him. I pray that you know him. I pray that you know him. Not only know about him, but have a personal experience, have a personal relationship with him, and your life will never be the same. You wouldn't want to go anywhere else. Praise God. Praise God. Because Paul, when he met Christ, his life also turned around, because he has met the great I am. Somebody say the great I am. Hallelujah. Great walls cannot stand against the great I am. No matter how great the wall is, that word, the answer that Jesus gave to Paul, that I am, that answer set him on a pilgrimage, set him on a quest. And throughout his ministry, he never lost sight of that answer, and it dragged him to his death. He died as a proud man. Hallelujah. He died as a proud man. He said, I have fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. Hallelujah. But over here in Philippians, he still had that burning in his heart. I want to know him. He said, Christ is the one who apprehended me. I want to know why he apprehended me. Hallelujah. And yet in Jesus' ministry on earth, when he was walking in Israel, he kept telling the people, I am. I am. I am. I am. And yet they never accepted him as the I am. They never accepted him. Hallelujah. Do you know? Do you know that Paul's letters were written years before John even wrote his gospel? Yeah. When they began to see what the Lord is doing through the Apostle Paul, when they began to see the revelation, then light began to break in their heart, all the disciples. Yes. Because Paul did not walk with Jesus physically. So he only saw Jesus in a vision as a spirit. No wonder he said, I refuse to know him by the flesh. He said, I don't want to know Christ by the flesh. I want to know him by the spirit. Because it is, it is in the spirit where the revelations are. Are you hearing me? It's in the spirit. It's in the spirit. Those who saw him physically, they saw him when he was hungry. They saw him when he was powerless. When the soldiers were beating him, they saw him. So it is not easy to put the two and two together if you see him in his weakness. But thank God for Paul. That's why Jesus was able to give all these revelations to Paul. If you read the letters of Paul, you receive more revelations. Because he didn't meet Jesus in the flesh, but he met him in the spirit. So he said, I will not know him after the flesh. I will know him after the spirit. If you want to know Christ, if you want to receive from him, if you want to walk with him, if you want to have intimate with him, you have to know him in the spirit, not in the flesh. Amen. Hallelujah. You have to taste and see. Hallelujah. Someone told me a story. Listen to me carefully. Oh, tonight is wonderful, isn't it? I hope you are soaking. You are soaking. Praise God. You are soaking. Someone told me a story that that person also heard it from somewhere. Okay, but he heard it from the person, I mean, the very first person who was in the story. Praise God. He said they were going to a different country. They were going to somewhere in the Europe, I think in America or Europe. They were going from Africa to the West. I will say the West. Praise God. And they were going by sea. So they were going in a ship. Somewhere, somehow, the ship capsized. He said, many people died, but the few people who made it to the lifeboat kept paddling. They kept paddling. Somebody said paddle. They kept paddling until they ran out of food and water. Yeah, they ran out of food and water. Although they were on the sea, but they were in a lifeboat. Praise God. They had no strength to paddle anymore. They couldn't drink the seawater because it's salty. Praise God. So they could not paddle anymore. Now they are stuck on the sea. Everybody is weak. No strength to paddle. So they began to die. For many days, some began to die of thirst. Although they were surrounded by water. Somebody say surrounded by water. Yet they were dying of thirst. Praise God. Because they knew that the water was salty. Until one of them said, well, I'm going to die anyway. So let me drink this water. And because I'm thirsty and I'm dying of thirst. And I'm surrounded by seawater. You understand? So let me drink it. Hey, don't do it. Hey, don't do it. Hey, don't do it. He just took the water and put it in his mouth. Tasted it. Not knowing they were on top of pure water. Pure water. Amen. Hallelujah. Say amen. Yeah, it's a big amen to that. I know this story will never leave your life. I know. Pure water. Pure water. Where they were, where the boat couldn't go, where their lifeboat couldn't go anymore, everywhere that surrounded the boat was filled with pure water. Hallelujah. 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 You see, one of them decided, if I die, I die. Everybody is dying anyway. And eventually, I am also going to die. So he said, let me drink the water. Hallelujah. So he took the water, not knowing that they were standing on top of pure water. Somebody say pure water. Pure. Hallelujah. Pure water. Pure water. Turn with me to Psalm 34. Hallelujah. Are you blessed that you came tonight? Oh, somebody say, Pastor is loaded. Somebody said the Holy Spirit is preaching good. Hallelujah. They were on top of water. And yet because they have heard that salty water kills people, they began to die one after the other. In Christ, when you come to Christ, you can only taste. Without tasting Christ, you can never experience Him. You can never know Him intimately until you begin to taste Him. Look at what Psalm 34 says. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make it boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt His name together. I sought the Lord, and He heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to Him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around all who fear Him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in Him. Let's read verse 8 again. Everybody shout aloud. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in Him. Hallelujah. Oh, fear the Lord, you His saints. There is no want to those who fear Him. The young lion lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall never lack any good thing. Come, you children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Who is the man who desires life and love many days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and His ears are open to His cry. Hallelujah. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off their remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and saves such as have a contrite spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. He guards all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous shall be condemned. The Lord redeems the soul of His servant, and none of those who trust in Him shall be condemned. Hallelujah. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. Hallelujah. 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 They were in the midst of pure water, and yet they were dying. Why? Because they did not taste. You said, that is the right response. When the word of God hits you, all you can say is, They were in the midst of pure water. All they needed to do was to taste. Praise God. Your preacher, your pastor sweats a lot. I scream, I jump. Praise God. I love jumping. You should have seen my music videos in my younger days. I can't stand still. Hallelujah. I can't stand still. Praise God. But all my screaming and my jumping and my sweating will not do you any good if you don't taste and see. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you don't taste and see. If you don't taste and see. He told them, I am. And yet they did not receive it. They did not receive Him. They did not taste. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You see, in the New Testament, it's filled with I am, I am, I am, I am. But you see, because of the translations during over all these years. So that is kind of hidden a little bit. But let me take you to some of the original Greek translations, and it will blow your mind. Not blow. If it blows your mind, it's not a good thing. Hallelujah. It will excite your heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at John. Go to the Gospel of John. I am almost done. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Look at the Gospel of John chapter 6. Look at verse 20. John 6:20. Hallelujah. Now we can start reading from verse 16. Now when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into the boat, and went over the sea towards Capernaum. And it was already dark, and Jesus had not come to them. Then the sea arose because of a great wind was blowing. Verse 19, when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and drawing near to the boat. And they were afraid. Somebody say fear. Praise God. Verse 20. But he said to them, it is I. Do not be afraid. It is I. Do not be afraid. Do you know the original Greek? The original Greek doesn't say this. The original Greek says that, and he saith, and Jesus saith, I am. That is the original Greek. It is only translated through the years that have sieved it down, and we are receiving this in the New King James Version. But the original Greek, Jesus saith to them, I am. Be not afraid. I am. Be not afraid. Hallelujah. Do you want to see one more? John chapter 4. John chapter 4. Go back. Hallelujah. John chapter 4. John chapter 4, 26. You know, in John chapter 4, from verse 19, he talked about the woman of Samaria in Sychar at the well in Samaria. You know the story. After they have had this interaction, look at verse 26. Or look at verse 25. We take it from verse 25. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. And look at verse 26. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you, am he. I who speak to you, am he. You know the original Greek? The original Greek says this. And Jesus said to him, Jesus said to her, who speak to thee? I am. Who speak to thee? I am. So you see that all through his earthly ministry, he keeps telling the people, I am. I am. I am. Hallelujah. In John chapter 8, verse 24. In John 8, 24, he said to them, except ye believe that I am, ye shall die in your sins. He said to them again, praise God. And we know this famous quote that I quote all the time in John 8, 58. John 8, 5, 8, he says, before Abraham was, I am. Praise God. Before Abraham was, I am. Hallelujah. He also said in John 8, 28, he said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then ye shall know that I am. Ye shall know that I am. Christ is still saying to you today, I am. My sister, he's still saying, I am. Hallelujah. Would you take the quality time in this season to get to know the great I am? Would you take that time to get to know the great I am. What is your goal for this season? We want to know him and the power of his resurrection. Would you join us to get to know this great I am? Praise God. We see that in recent years, Christianity has received a lot of bad publicity. You understand? A few apples, a few bad apples and oranges have come to contaminate. You understand? It has to contaminate everything. So even now, God is calling people to ministry and they are afraid, because if you say you are a pastor, hey, everybody will say, ah, here goes one of them. If you say you are a prophet, ah, I'm a crowd, they're worse. Hey, no. You understand? If you say you are an apostle, oh, there goes one of them. So because of that, people resist the call of God. Yes, it is true. It is true. Do you know that all the people in the lifeboat would have died? They would have died. Because they have heard that salt water will kill them. Will kill them faster. Hallelujah. Praise God. Probably some of them in the lifeboat even tasted the salt water and died. Praise God. Probably. I was not there, but I'm just assuming. Praise God. Because something made them to resist drinking that water. Even though I was talking to Mr. K yesterday, and this morning Mr. K is dead. He has died of thirst. What? Just like the four lepers. They say, why stay here until we die? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But one of them defied the odds. Says, I will drink it. Not knowing that Christ was setting them up. That where they were, the waters has been healed. The waters have been healed. And they were standing on top of their breakthrough. And they were still crying. They were, oh my God, my God, my God, my God, my God. Did Christ come into your life to make you poor? No. But he says, seek me first. Riches are in me. I own the cattle of 1,000 hills. They are all in me. If you seek me first, get to know me. Build a relationship with me. Get intimate with me. And all of these things I will give to you. And that is where the problem is. That is where the problem is. That is where the problem is. It's like somebody that they go to the doctor and the doctor says, stop smoking. If you don't stop smoking, you will die. Oh, it becomes like a curse. That is when they will smoke more. Only a few will heed the advice of the doctor. That's why Jesus said, many are called, but only a few are chosen. Are you among the chosen? Are you among the chosen? Or you are among the crowd? Praise God. Because the gate is wide. Let me take the easy road. Praise God. Praise God. Tonight, Christ is calling you as he's speaking to your heart. As he met Saul on the road to Damascus, he said to Saul, I am. And that word, I am, sent Saul on the path to his destiny. And he never stopped searching. He never stopped searching. Christ is saying to you tonight, I am. I am. Are you searching for peace? I am. Are you searching for joy? Are you searching for joy? I am. Are you searching for rest? I am. Are you searching for eternal life? I am. Praise God. Whatever you are searching, the essential things in your life that you are searching, Christ is saying to you, I am. Come to me first. All you who labor and are heavy laden. And I, said Jesus, I will give you rest. I will give you rest. Would you take his rest? Would you find time this season? Spend quality time. Set quality goals. That I put all things aside. Paul said, I count all this loss that I may gain Christ. Can you say that tonight? That I may gain Christ. I want to gain Christ. So I'm putting all things aside that I may gain Christ. And when you find him, you will know. And you will not want anything else. You will not want anything else. Hallelujah. So this will end my topic for tonight. Knowing the great I am. If you search, you will find the great I am. He's saying to you today, I am still the great I am. He said to Moses, go and tell the elders of Israel. If they ask you that who sent you, tell them, I am that I am. It was the same Jesus who was speaking to Moses. That same Jesus is speaking to you. In the book of Revelation, Jesus met with John. And still he was saying to John, I am he who died, but now I am alive forevermore. He is alive, Crown House. God did not send me here to preach a dead Christ. He sent me here to preach a living and vibrant Christ. Hallelujah. He will be alive in your life. Your life will be full of the life of Christ. Hallelujah. Give him the chance. Give him the opportunity and get to know him, and you will see that life will begin to make sense to you. It doesn't take $1 million to make you happy. It doesn't take $1 million to bring you joy, but Christ will bring you joy. He will fulfill your joy. I promise you. Give him the opportunity. Give him the opportunity. Hallelujah. Stand up on your feet. Praise God and give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Oh, Father, we praise you. We love you, Lord. 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 Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord.